morning. It's great that you could join us here at Bentley Baptist Church for our online service. I'm sure that by now most of you are used to the way we do things, but if you're new or you've just forgotten, then we're going to start with a time of worship, and this week's songs have been chosen by Ruth, so I just encourage you to engage with them. Following that, we're going to have this week's word, and it's being brought to us by Ian. And then to finish, we're going to have notices so we can keep updated and then a chance to pray together. So grab yourself a cuppa and get ready to praise the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, His holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger, Your name His soul.
burn this truth in our land. Of our God who reigns on high, by his grace again we'll fly.
Whilst he was saying these things to them, behold, a ruler came in and knelt before him, saying, My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live. And Jesus rose and followed him with his disciples. And behold, a woman who had suffered from a discharge of blood for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his garment. For she said to herself, If I only touch this garment, I will be made well. Jesus turned and, seeing her, said, Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well. And instantly the woman was made well. And when Jesus came to the ruler's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, Go away, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl arose. And the report of this went through all that district.
Good morning. This is a great story found in the three Gospels, Matthew, Mark and Luke. And there are three main characters in this story. There's the ruler, there's the woman, and of course Jesus. Now Matthew, the one that we've just read, gives the shortest account of the encounter between these characters. But the other two Gospels fill in a few more details. So you can check out later this week Mark 5, 21-43 or Luke 8, 40-46, where we find out a little bit more about the people involved. We found out that the man was named Jairus and he was a synagogue ruler, and that his daughter was near death when he set out, but as he was talking to Jesus she died, and his daughter was just 12 years old. It's interesting that we're also told that the woman suffered for 12 years. She's given no name in any of the Gospels, but she'd spent all that she had on physicians and doctors, and it says that she suffered much in their care. Despite this, she wasn't getting any better. She was only getting worse.
Jesus attracted people from all walks of life, and our story today clearly represents this. We have two people who were at either end of the social spectrum. So let's have a look at our two characters in more detail. So firstly, we have the man, and men were thought of much more highly than women in those days. Not only was he a man, but he was a man of prominence. He was the ruler of a Jewish synagogue, which was the centre of religious activity. And he was given a name in the Gospels. We learn of his name. He was called Jairus. So he was a somebody. He would have been highly respected amongst the people. They would have gone to listen to him and to gain instruction from him. So he had a certain level of authority. He also had a home and a family. So he was someone who was used to having people listening to him and doing as they were asked. So he came to Jesus quite openly. Indeed, his level of authority may well have led him to expect an audience with Jesus, and the crowd would have made way for him so that he could get to Jesus quite easily. So Jairus was a man of great importance in the people's eyes. He was knowledgeable, he had authority, he had high standing. In contrast, the woman in the story, firstly she was a woman, and she'd suffered for many years. She'd suffered from bleeding for 12 years. And the custom and the law in that day would have meant that she was unclean. People would not have wanted to go near her. She would have had to socially distance herself. People would not have wanted to touch her, or to touch anything that she'd touched, or even to sit anywhere where she had sat, because they themselves would become unclean. So this woman would have been on the fringe of society. She was not able to worship in the synagogue or take part in any religious activity. So she was also very poor. She spent all her money on doctors in trying to find a cure for a condition. So this meant that she came to Jairus, to Jesus, in a very different way to Jairus. She had to push her way through the crowd. She came from behind, and she tried to remain hidden. She was ashamed of her condition. So, recapping, Jairus was a man of importance in people's eyes. He was knowledgeable, he had authority and high social standing. The woman, by contrast, was on the fringes of society, socially outcast, poor, and this meant that they went to Jesus in a very different way. Do we relate to either of these people? From the synagogue ruler to the poor woman is represented the whole expanse of society. They were at opposite ends of society. Yet it was what they had in common, not what separated them, that drew them to the feet of Jesus.
They were both of them united in desperation. They both reached the end of their own ability to deal with the situation that they were in. And they both needed a miracle. Neither person had asked for these problems. They hadn't done anything to deserve this. Life had just thrown them a curveball. They both recognized that life can send things that are our way beyond our influence or beyond our control. And this wasn't part of either of their life plans. Both saw the future and it was without hope. And they were both desperate for hope. And that desperation led them to the feet of Jesus. It does raise the question, doesn't it? Why does God allow these things to happen? Why do trials and things come our way, which seem to have nothing to do with our own choice or actions? And if they're the sorts of questions you're asking, there's a great guy you can listen to on YouTube, Ravi Zacharias. I encourage you to go and have a listen to some of the things he has to say about that topic. But C.S. Lewis writes, "We can ignore even pleasure, but pain, that insists on being attended to. God whispers in our pleasure, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pain. It's his megaphone to rouse a deaf world." And in this moment here, in this story, yeah, Jesus could have gone early, he could have got there before the girl died, but this temporary loss that Jesus seems to allow is there to show an eternal abundance of God's blessing. So that moment of pain to get across an eternal abundance of God's blessing and to show what he can do. And it was their suffering and their desperation that actually led them to the feet of Jesus. Both would have recognized Jesus, they would have known about him, they'd have heard stories about this teacher who healed, and they'd maybe listened to him teach, they'd perhaps seen others healed, maybe seen feed people or set people free. Jairus, as one of the ruler of the synagogue, who would have had many conversations, I'm sure, with the religious leaders of the time about this new upcoming preacher and his claims. And many of the religious leaders at the time, they were very standoffish. Jesus didn't want to really associate with him. They didn't like his claims. Those that did approach him often approached at night or in secret. So Jairus would have maybe been a bit also standoffish initially in terms of approaching Jesus, but then he found that his need was much more important
than his social standing. And when we realise that our need for Jesus is greater than what the world might think of us, then we also need to go and bow the knee. Jairus was willing to risk his reputation based on what he'd heard and seen for the sake of his daughter. The woman as well, she also risked much. She wasn't allowed to touch others, to make contact with others, because she'd make them unclean, and yet there she was, and pushing her way through the crowd. Had she been noticed, she would have risked punishment, and yet she put her faith and her hope in Jesus. Put her faith in what she'd seen and what she'd heard. And it says that she reached to grab the tassels or the hem of Jesus' garment. Now, Numbers 15:38 says that the tassels, there were four of them on the garment that the Jews wore. And in them, they would put a blue thread, and that thread represented and reminded them of the law and the commandments of God. And she said, if only I can touch the hem, she would be healed. And it's also significant at the time that this wouldn't have been lost on the Jewish people. And she would have known of Malachi 4, verse 2, that says the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in his wings. And it's the same word for tassels in Numbers as it is for wings in Malachi 4, verse 2. So where it says the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings, the word wings is the same word that's used for tassels in Numbers, to say that on the end of the garment they should have these tassels that remind them of the commandments and the law that God had given. And when you realize the significance of this concept to the Jews of the time, you can see why this woman reached out and thought to herself, if only I can touch those tassels, I will be healed. She was expressing her faith in Jesus as the Son of Righteousness, who would rise with healing in his wings. She was declaring that Jesus was the Messiah. And Jesus turned around to her and said, your faith has made you well. Your understanding in who I am has made you well. And it's interesting about faith. It was her faith that made her well, and her faith was knowing who Jesus was. And the more we know Jesus, the more we grow in our faith and that we act accordingly. And also in a beautiful moment at the end of that encounter, Jesus had not only healed her of a bleeding, but also turned around and called her daughter. He didn't just give her a name. Jairus had a name, the woman didn't. But he didn't give her a name, he gave her a relationship. He made her family and he called her daughter. And that wouldn't have just healed her from bleeding, but it would have healed her from all that emotional scarring, I'm sure, as well, to make her part of his family, to call her daughter. So can you relate to one of those two people in the story? In many ways, we're in the very same boat that they're in. We are all faced by the fragile nature of life and our own mortality, whether that be something sudden and unexpected, or whether that's something that's progressive over time. The Bible says that all man is destined to die, and after that to face judgment. And that's something beyond our ability and beyond our power to control. And the two people in the story, it was that desperate situation, that realization that led them to the feet of Jesus. Jairus and the woman both placed their trust and their hope in Jesus. I love the two words that the woman thinks as she's approaching Jesus. She says, if only.
And really, I think those two words can sum up life for us. For many of us, it can be, if only I hadn't, if only I didn't, if only this hadn't happened, if only that person hadn't done this, if only I wasn't in this situation, if only I could grasp this, if only I could get hold of that. And life becomes full of if onlys. And we need to be the same as the woman. Our if only needs to be if only I can grab hold and get close to Jesus. These two characters represent Jesus restoring relationship with him. And they also show his power over death. Perhaps you're watching this and you're realizing that you're faced by a hopeless situation. You know, with everything that's going on in the world around us, we're all faced with our own mortality, if you like. And I would encourage you to do what both of these people did, which is to put their hope and their faith in Jesus Christ, to bow the knee, to kneel before him and declare him as Lord and Saviour of your life. It says in Romans 5 that God showed his love for us in this, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. And our hope is shown in this story. Our hope of restoration with God, a relationship with God, and a hope in the resurrection to a new glorious future. And for many of us listening, we'll have already, at some point in our lives, have already made that step of committing our lives to Jesus and following him. So who do we identify with in this story? Well, there's one other character. There's Jesus himself. And my question to you is, are you reflecting Jesus in your life at the moment to those that you come into contact with? In the early church, those that followed Jesus were called Christians, and we still are today. But when they were first called Christians, it was given as an insult, and it meant little Christs. And it was an insult, or people thought it was an insult, to call these followers of Jesus little Christs. And, you know, the early followers of Jesus owned that word, because yeah, they were. That's what they were meant to be. They were meant to be like Christ. So my question is, are we acting like sons and daughters of the King? Are we offering that hope of Jesus into desperate lives and desperate situations? And is our faith based on the person and knowledge of who Jesus is? And are we growing ever closer to him and in relationship with him? The world's in a desperate place right now. It always has been, but I think it's really brought to the forefront of people's minds at the moment, and that provides a great opportunity. And are we looking for and finding ways of bringing Jesus into this desperate situation and this desperate world? So let us, as heirs and co-heirs with Christ, as his sons and daughters, bring the hope that we found into this world that's lacking in hope. And let us be brave enough to step beyond that which is comfortable and be willing to risk it all for the sake of others.
Let's remember this morning that God blesses us so that we can be a blessing to others. So as we pray, let's pray blessing upon those we know and love and the situations we find ourselves in. Father God, we pray your blessing upon our families, and through our families, that we might bless our neighbours, the communities we live in, our friends, the people that we work with and associate with. Father, we pray your blessing upon them. We pray your blessing upon those that live in Bentley, in the area that as church we serve. We pray that they may know a richness in finding you as their hope and as their peace. Father, we pray a blessing upon them and all those that are working for the good of that community. Father, we pray a blessing upon the councillors and those who work to oversee the Doncaster and surrounding area. Father, we pray a blessing for wisdom and for insight to make right and wise decisions. We pray a blessing upon those that work in our schools, and we pray a blessing particularly on those schools that they represent. Father, give them safety, security and wisdom in all that they do at this time. For those that work in caring professions, in the community or in hospital or in care homes, Father, we pray your blessing and your protection upon them. Father, we also pray that at this time you would bless this nation. You would bless this nation as it seeks to find a way through this difficult time. But may it find a way to you at this difficult time. We thank you that you are a God who loves to bless. I'm going to use a blessing that was given through Aaron. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Let's continue to seek to bless in the name of the Lord through today and this coming week.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you.
Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children.
And a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and their children,
and their children.
Thank you for joining us this week. We hope you've enjoyed the service. If you want to get in contact with us throughout the week, then make sure to check out the church website, because all the information and details you'll need will be on there. We hope you have a good week, and we'll see you again next Sunday. Bye!